Braddock is a very old town. This is the town that essentially built America. Our steel is the steel that catapulted the United States into the Industrial Revolution. And that's an awesome history to have. But there is a lot of illness in this area, and there is a lot of pollution. That's kind of the untold story about the steel mill. I'm Summer Lee. I'm running to be state representative for District 34 in Pennsylvania.
What's up with this sexy music? They're trying to record us talking and stuff. And you got this love making
music
going.
What kind of music you want to hear for?
I don't think we're going to have any music going.
Really?
It's Mother's Day, and I'm out here knocking with my mom and my nephew. And my sister is knocking, too. You tell them what their polling place is. If you are voting for the opposition, don't forget that election day is on Wednesday.
What are you doing?
I grew up here. I grew up in these neighborhoods. I went to our local public school. I mean, we were a desegregation case in like the 80s. Braddock had to fight for good education and to be included in the education systems of the suburbs around us because they didn't want us. It was a huge fight. It's where I started to look at my own community more critically, where I started to see the cycle. I wanted to be a civil rights activist when I grew up. It's like not a real job. I mean, you don't get paid to be like Malcolm X. I would have done that if it was a job, though. But I kind of am, in a sense. I guess in a sense, I mean, it is what I'm doing. Hi, you have my flyer in your hand. Yes. I'm Summer, nice to meet you.
I'm Kim, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too. I just wanted to come by and introduce myself to see, make sure that you heard about our election day.
Yes, I
know it's coming up and to see if you had any questions about election day.
I do not.
All right.
I support you 100%.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. Across the country, we have largely communities of color that are poor, that have polluters in it, or that have polluters very near to it. They are medical deserts. They're typically food deserts. And I was like, wow. My community literally epitomizes that. Right now in Braddock, reports show the air quality is amongst the worst in the nation. We have tremendous asthma rates, well above the national average. If you talk to anybody in this community, they'll tell you about the time when there would be smog or whatever, the particles that would come down that would like leave glitter on their hand. They explain it as like glitter. This is what's happening in our communities. When you live in an impoverished town, you're desperate for anything that can come in here and generate some sort of revenue and generate some sort of jobs. So when oil and gas comes, they're like, hey, we'll throw you a bone. We'll give you a couple dollars. We're more likely to lay our health on the table because at the end of the day, it's like we're poor or we're unhealthy. But there's no reason for us to be both at the same time. In our district, we've actually had a few fracking proposals. There's always chances that it will pollute your water. We've all heard of communities that are near fracking wells that have seismic activity. You know, if you live within a 2-mile radius of the fracking well, infants are more likely to have low birth rate. That's a problem. And I think it's disingenuous for people to tell us that we should just shut up and accept it. We live in a society that is now over-reliant on resources that are not sustainable. We know that dirty industry has to go somewhere. Pollution has to go somewhere. They're gonna put it into the places with the most vulnerable people who have zero political capital. They're not people who can speak up for themselves when those decisions are being made. What that basically says is that not only are you poor, not only are you black, but also, because you're those things, you don't deserve as clean an air as we do. You don't deserve clean water. Polluters always find their way to black communities and to poor communities. And people just expect us to, you know, just be okay with it. I bet people like us would get down there and say, oh no, we don't want that here. Y'all didn't want that next to your school. We don't want that next to our school either. That's what we're fighting for the power to do. We just want to be able to say, just like the rich people, that no, we don't want that in our community. Why shouldn't it be us who's controlling it? It's not impossible. I want to live in a society that accepts my blackness, my womanness, and that is not always at war with it. I want to work to dismantle this cyclical racism that I'm looking at right now. My campaign headquarters is the shop. I mean, in the Black community, barbershop is the center of the community. It's where you go to get your gossip, it's where you go to get your news, it's where you go to share your politics and your ideas. So I thought it was really fitting to have our campaign headquarters like out of the barbershop. I actually did my hair in it once too, so it's really convenient. I just wanted to introduce myself. I'm running for state representative. You know, we have an environmental issue going on right now with the Edgar Thompson steel mill. There's a fracking proposal down there.
Honestly, I'm voting for the other candidate.
So okay.
He's a personal friend.
So. Okay.
Okay, thank you
All
for
right.
your time.
All right, have a good one.
Bye.
He's a friend. You know what I usually say there? I'm like, okay, well, May 15th, when I'm still your representative. What you gonna say then? We're going up against the establishment. We're going up against a name, we're going up against the old boys network. Everything that conventional wisdom would tell a young Black girl from Braddock that she couldn't do. When people who control development in your communities always look to the outside when they go to develop new businesses or to attract new residents, what you're telling us is that we don't have inherent value, that we didn't have value before you came. And that's not true. There's value in our communities already. There's problems in our communities, but there's value still. So I just want us to be a part of it. If we're gonna talk about remedying racial disparities, we have to shift from talking about what Black folk need to do and what people of color need to do, and we need to address the fact that racism is a white person issue. We can't solve racism. These issues are still going to plague people of color. So we have to talk about how do we now change policies. You rarely see people in these offices who are from communities that are impacted. At the end of the day, in Black communities, if we are now getting into places and positions of power where we do get to create our own policies, we're not going to be able to get rid of those policies that negatively impact us. Local politics is where we can do something. We can liberate ourselves through organizing. We can couple our activism fighting the power by seizing political power. And I think that's what we have the opportunity to do.
It's election day eve. I'm tired and I could probably use a shower. I really think that we have the more energized electorate, but turnout is traditionally low.
You're getting ready to have an election tomorrow.
Tomorrow
you're voting, right? Summer
league. Yeah. All right, I got you.
At this point, it's in the voters' hands. Do the people who said, yeah, I support you, you know, yeah, we'll come out, do they actually come? Tomorrow, we will see. Good morning.
Excuse me.
Yep.
I never met you. I'm Paul's older brother.
Oh, you look like him.
How are you?
Summer Lee, nice to meet you. Good luck to you all. Well, I mean, I don't mean that, but you know. Good morning, my name is Summer Lee.
How you doing?
Nice to meet you.
Okay, you running for
I'm running for state representative.
Yeah, you're the Summer Lee.
I am.
I see your picture everywhere.
Ugh. Yeah, friend El Costa.
Yeah, I just saw a Costa out
did
there.
You? Okay.
You did.
Yeah,
good. Oh, good God, they brought in more reinforcements. I have the whole Costa family now. You, sir, they are making you obsolete. And you should tell them that you have this handled.
I work very well with the Costa brothers.
That's wonderful. You will
We've
hopefully.
Been friends for a long
I certainly years. Hope that you will work well with me too when I'm your state representative.
I understand. The difference is on local elections, it literally will come down to one or two votes.
We have about 20 minutes left until the last people can get to the polls. We're just trying to call every last person to see if they voted or if we can get them a last minute ride to the polls. Turnout in a lot of places didn't look great this morning, but now it's looking great, which is good, but we'll see.
All right, thank you. Paul Costa.
Shut up. What'd he say?
Correct.
Shut up, what did he say?
He was just like, congratulations, you kicked my ass. I wish I had wrote something. It has been an honor of my life running this. And we have elected the first black woman to ever win. You saw what we can do. You saw what happens when people unite. We have power. This is where power is. This is how we build power. Your politicians are your servants. If they are not serving you, get rid of them.
Oftentimes, our communities never see victories, not victories that's tangible to us. So once you start seeing that we can be victorious, you're like, okay, the system is something that we can conquer. It's not something that we can only be a victim to. We can absolutely make sure that these industries are being conscious of the people who are left behind, the people who live right next door. It's the only way. It is the only way. We're worth that. We're worth that.